Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Build Better, Live Better by the Academy of Urbanism in collaboration with the RIAI and sponsored by Reddy Architecture and Urbanism. Before we begin, a few housekeeping issues. We are recording today's session, so if you don't want to be seen, please switch off your cameras and your microphones. Ask questions and comment on the talks throughout the session using the chat box. These comments and questions will be picked up by our chair as we go through. If you'd like to tweet, the hashtag is AOU Housing, and the Academy can be followed on at the AOU. And a quick plug for our next major event, which is taking place later this month with the Urban Design Group, the 15-Minute City. Today's event is sponsored by Reddy Architecture and Urbanism, and it is in collaboration with the RIAI. Big thanks to both of those organizations for their support. And more widely, thank you to the Academy's sponsors. We're very grateful for the support they give us throughout the year. The next Academy conference on housing will take place on the 12th of February in 2021. So many of the ideas that come out of today will be taken forward to that event. So please put that date in your diary. Today's program is split into two. For those attending the afternoon session, please note there is a separate Zoom link for this. Check the email confirmation which was emailed out to you, and if you didn't receive that, please let us know throughout this event at some point using the chat box. And with that, I'll hand over to Tony Reddy, who is the chair of the Academy of Urbanism.
Thank you, Stephen. Colleagues, I'd like to welcome all of you to this first online full-day event entitled Build Better, Live Better. This event was originally planned as a series of events to occur in England, Ireland, Scotland and Wales, and we had the first of these events as a follow-up to our Congress in Eindhoven. It was held in London on the 6th of February and was organised by my colleagues Brianna Savage and Janet Sutherland. But of course, the Academy's affairs, as the affairs of all the world, were affected by the COVID pandemic. And what it has forced us to do, and it has changed the Academy in ways we could never have anticipated, it's forced us to go to an online platform. But the effect of that is that the Academy has a wide range of links throughout the world. It has allowed us to begin to think in terms of an event like this as one that could involve all of the, both England, Ireland, Scotland, Wales, and Denmark in one big event. And I hope you're going to find it very interesting. It's a new challenge. I suspect we will look back in it, on it as a very significant event in terms of the way the Academy actually communicates with members and indeed the wider public. Many of our other events throughout the year are also having to move to this platform. So it gives me great pleasure to open the proceedings, and I'm now going to hand over to my colleague Stephen Hill of the UK Co-Housing Network, who's going to chair the first event. And let me just say to you that as a sign of how we move internationally, Stephen was actually on a mountain in Kerry doing tests yesterday and everything went very well. He came down to get a better signal in the town of Tralee in an architect's office, and he almost had a disastrous start here because the signal didn't work. But that's one of they're the challenges that going online lead to. So I think he's up and running now and with a very clear signal. So you're very welcome, Stephen.
Thank you very much, Tony. Good morning, everybody. yes, I am sitting in the hut. Town of Tralee, connected to somebody else's computer and their phone. So I hope all will be well for the course of this morning. this morning's session and the conference generally, the Build Better, Live Better. These are two very important aspects. We spend a lot of time thinking about the build bit, and in the UK at the moment, the big driver for post-COVID reconstruction comes from Prime Minister Johnson's build, build, build speech. which says a little bit about affordable housing, but nothing that specific. And now a planning white paper that proposes a radical reform of the planning system, with a commitment to build at least as much affordable housing as we're doing at the moment, but a kind of a less than full vision of what affordable housing is, why it's important, not just for the people who live there, but for the working of the economy and for the working of the housing markets. So I think it's important, therefore, that we also focus on the live better bit of it, because in a sense, if we can't live better, why are we doing it at all? And I think that the COVID experience has reminded us, if we needed reminding, that for some people, affordable housing is a life and death choice. We know that in boroughs like Brent and Newham in London, where there is inadequate supplies of affordable housing, where there are a kind of rampant exploitation of people through an unregulated private rented sector. So typically a small terrace house may be subdivided into three apartments, all overcrowded, and quite possibly a garden shed or garage housing another two households. So for some people, this has been a death experience, and we need to be reminded of that. In 2009, following the great financial crash, Gordon Brown said that investment in affordable housing was a moral duty. And I think we need to recognize that that's what it is. That feels like a very good introduction to Professor Peter Roberts. Peter and I have never met, but I know his work tremendously well. He's one of the kind of great fountains of knowledge on regeneration and community development. And for a brief time, he was the brave founder chair of the Academy of Sustainable Urbanism, Academy of Sustainable Communities, which was a great attempt to try and capture knowledge and learning, which I think is something that we at the Academy are very good at doing, but could clearly do a lot better. We're often having to relearn stuff that we were doing 20, 30, or even longer ago. So it's my very great pleasure to introduce Peter with a very moral tone, the forgotten human right. So over to you, Peter, and you've got 15 minutes.
Righto, thank you very much indeed, Stephen. I'm not sure about a fount of knowledge. I'll make a few faltering points, I think, this morning. The Gordon Brown quotation is really important. And can I remind you, actually, under Gordon Brown's prime ministership, the Homes and Communities Agency was established. And one of the purposes of the Homes and Communities Agency was to actually promote the development and accelerate the growth of social housing. And a number of points through the presentation this morning, I'm going to make the point that affordable housing is not necessarily social housing. Anyway, next slide, please, Stephen. The focus is on the human rights dimension of social and affordable housing. And I've set it, as you might expect, following Stephen's introduction in the context of sustainable communities, because I do think it's hugely important that it's not just about the home or the house, it's also about the place where that is. And much of what I'm going to say this morning reflects the unique condition of housing in Northern Ireland, and the legacy of the often troubled history of housing in Northern Ireland. And inevitably, because I chair it, it reflects the work of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive. And it deals with issues which I think do actually reflect the wider objective of this event, because one of the strap lines which I've introduced to the Northern Ireland Housing Executive is that we deal with people, property, places, and increasingly environmental issues, and the shorthand for that and the alliterative shorthand is planet. Next slide, please, Stephen. The context, the right to and access and security of tenure of housing have been really serious long-standing issues in Northern Ireland. Anybody who knows Northern Ireland and its history, and especially the history of the Troubles, will realize that access to and the right to secure safe housing was at the center of many of those tragic events. I've given you a few statistics here. Between 1969 and 1973, some 60,000 people were displaced, 14,000 homes destroyed. And this was at the foundation of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, which celebrates its birthday in 2021, its 50th birthday. Compounding these problems, Northern Ireland had a legacy of poor and unfit housing, and also quite unique in the four nations of the UK, and also in relation to the Republic, we have a major segregation of communities. Even today, 20 years plus after the Good Friday Agreement, 90% of our housing estates are single identity estates. And compounding again all of this, Northern Ireland is the poorest of the four UK nations. Stephen, next slide, please. If we move to human rights, why have I chosen to do this? Well, because I truly feel the burden of the human rights agenda pressing upon us in Northern Ireland when we're dealing with social and affordable housing. And because the right to adequate housing is a fundamental part of the right to an adequate standard of living, which has been enshrined in the UN Universal Declaration of Human Rights since 1948. Subsequent national and international treaties and agreements reflect this right, and as a consequence, for me, those people who are involved in the provision of social and affordable housing are not just property managers, they're custodians of a basic human right. And I can't emphasize that enough. You are responsible for other people's rights and their welfare. But the right to housing is often forgotten. There's a favorite Northern Ireland expression about shroud waving. Well, the problem for the social housing sector in Northern Ireland is that it doesn't wave the shroud enough. And compared to the crises in relation to healthcare, food security, education, and public safety, we don't say enough about this basic human right. Next slide, please. Unlike England, the three Celtic nations do not have a legally defined affordable sector. I know in England, because I was on the board of the HCA at the time, that affordable is defined as 80% of market rental. We don't have that at the moment in Northern Ireland. And of course, the thing that affordable, using the term affordable housing, the thing that it often shields or disguises is that you've got housing which is slightly less unaffordable than other unaffordable housing for many people. And social housing, therefore, is for me the fundamental way of delivering people's human rights. But the percentage provision of social housing varies considerably between the four UK nations. Next slide, please, Stephen. As you can see here, in Northern Ireland, 16% of all dwellings are social homes. In Wales, 15.9%, in Scotland, 22.9%, and in England, 16.7%. The difference you'll notice on that chart is that in Northern Ireland, the housing associations provide a minority of social homes, and the majority is provided by the Northern Ireland Housing Executive. Northern Ireland councils are beginning to introduce affordable housing as a means of extending the social housing offer, and that's being done through community plans and local development plans. The most advanced of these is the local development plan for Belfast, which is currently going through the process of consultation and modification prior to its, hopefully, its approval. But we're not there yet. Certainly we're dealing with a number of schemes now where on a voluntary experimental basis, developers are talking with the council and with ourselves about introducing affordable housing. For example, Belfast is looking for something like 20% of all new homes in the city to be social and affordable. And we tend to, at this moment in time, to interpret that as 10% social, 10% affordable. And 10% social in Northern Ireland terms means 10% at 50% of market rent. Next slide, please, Stephen. Provision in Northern Ireland of social housing is concentrated in the Housing Executive. The reason for this is that in 1971, following the Housing Executive Northern Ireland Act, the housing association sector was virtually absent, and the local authority stock and some other stock from new towns, etc., was put into the hands of the Housing Executive. And central to the role of the executive as a public social landlord was and still is the need to ensure that allocations to social housing were objective, unbiased, and based on need and availability. And in 1974, the housing selection scheme was introduced to try and deliver this. Next slide, please, Stephen. Some key issues for Northern Ireland social housing. Northern Ireland is the poorest nation in the UK, £439 median household weekly income before housing costs compared to the UK. And it's a less resilient society. We can see that the percentage of households in financial difficulty is significant. The percentage of over-indebted households, 20%, and households with less than £10,000 saving, 60%. As a consequence, some 13% of households are in receipt of housing benefit, which still exists in Northern Ireland, or the universal credit housing element, compared to a GB average of 10%. Next slide, please, Stephen. And some household costs are much higher than in GB. Energy, which is less dependent on gas and more on oil and other fuels, is about 16% more expensive. And there are some significant spatial variations in Northern Ireland. Places like Belfast and Derry City and Strabane have extremely high levels of housing stress. Next slide, please, Stephen. And my guess is I've got 6 minutes left. Right, so housing and human rights in Northern Ireland, ideas of contested space, sectarian territoriality and segregation through physical barriers, so-called peace walls, and other informal barriers, some of which are temporary, are not normally the things that social housing landlords, affordable housing landlords, have to deal with. But these are quite normal in Northern Ireland. Brendan Murta talks about the housing costs of segregation and territoriality. Paddy Gray talks about having to operate a scheme to allocate properties in a fair and equitable manner. And God help you if you don't do that. Next slide, please. And in practice, that means that allocations have to be based on agreed criteria applied by all social landlords, that we do have to regard communities as an entity, as a whole. We can't just deal with housing. And we do have to look at social welfare. And that we've developed probably a more extensive range of accompanying services to the social homes than elsewhere in the UK. And finally, we are very aware of the fact that any changes to community balance are treated initially with a degree of suspicion. So what has social housing done for Northern Ireland? It's next slide, please, Stephen. It's produced a whole series of services. And this is just a sort of word wall, very appropriate. Most of the walls in Northern Ireland are covered in words, and this is covered in words. These are the sort of things we've done to make livable places as well as affordable housing. Next slide, please, Stephen. And finally, some reflections and a view forward. Social housing remains for me a major positive force for good in Northern Ireland. It helps to drive change. It helps to maintain sustainable communities. We've got some interesting experiments which are now mature, together building united communities, the Teabuck experiment, where people commit to moving and into communities, new communities, living together, working together to make that community sustainable without the normal additions to the built environment, which you see elsewhere in many of our estates, such as flags and graffiti. And some of those experiments are now proving really positive. However, some of the earlier advantages that the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, which is a younger stock profile following years of redevelopment and a relatively low level of turnover, have dropped away in recent times. And there's been an increasing gap between supply and demand. And this event is taking place at a really important point in time for Northern Ireland, because we're now engaged in a debate now that we've got ministers back in post in terms of where do we go with our social housing development program? How do we close the gap between supply and demand? Our collective acceptance and implementation of a people, property, places and planet approach, I think, has really been reinforced in recent years. And Stephen, you've made reference to the Brent Independent Poverty Commission. And I think that adds real weight to my point that social and affordable housing is a human right. I think it is absolutely fundamental that we work through a sustainable communities model. I also think we need to work hand in glove with people like organizations like climate commissions, because we need livable places in a rounded sense now and in the future. So what do I envisage and what do I hope for over the next years in Northern Ireland and more generally? In the future, I envisage a new round of housing improvements, the reprovisioning of stock and additions to the stock of social affordable housing. And this stock will be delivered at an even higher level of social welfare, with more homes for affordable rent rather than real affordable rent through social rent rather than token affordable rent, which some of the affordable housing is. These homes will have much higher levels of energy performance, and it will be in accord with the priorities of something which Northern Ireland and Scotland benefit from, which is joined up policy thinking and delivery between the public, private and voluntary sector through community planning. So as ever, and Janice, you'll be able to reflect on this, I retain my optimism despite some of the challenges, and I just hope that we can actually manage to put that forgotten human right in the spotlight and make sure that it isn't forgotten anymore, because it shouldn't be. It is, as Gordon Brown said, a moral disgrace that we don't provide people with decent homes. Thank you. And that, to me, is 15 minutes, a half minute. I apologise. 30 seconds over.
You did completely. And I lost my that you would be way over time. So thank you very much for that. And I'm glad you're optimistic. I had reason to be in Belfast in 1970, and with colleagues, we simply could not understand the different qualities of living conditions between the two communities. In the early days, the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, I know working under local authority in London, we did actually look to the executive for some of the very high standards of new house building that they were putting in place, and were a kind of great guide to us. So, and I'm glad that you're there to continue the work. Now the next speaker is Janice Morphet. Janice is one of those people who is excellent at shining a light on difficult issues that we all find hard to grapple with. I think back particularly to the changes in planning law in UK in 2004, when we stopped having a land use planning system and went over to a spatial planning system. And she was one of the people who tried to help us all understand what the difference was. And I think she would probably admit that We didn't quite make it all the way until other reform came along. But spatial planning is a very important concept, and it does embrace the whole idea of sustainable communities and building for the social, environmental, and economic well-being of places. In her speech today, she's going to talk about the work that local authorities are doing in restarting their own house building activities. So over to you, Janice.
Right, thank you very much, Stephen. And just to continue as well from the kinds of issues that Peter has been discussing and introducing us to in Northern Ireland. What I'm going to say is based on two pieces of research I've done with a colleague, Ben Clifford, in 2017 and 2019. And I think that you are going to be given the web links for the detail for the research reports. So I'm just going to talk you through generally what we found based on this research, which included a direct survey, 100% desk survey of all councils in England, and we only refer to England. In each year, we had 10 round tables in every region, one in every region of England, and each time we had over 10 case studies. So there's quite a lot of material in the reports if you want to look at them. And really what we wanted to find out was why were councils starting to re-engage in delivery of housing? And what were they doing about it? And what was successful? So what lessons could we learn? So there were three groups of reasons why councils are re-engaging. The first is that they felt that they should. Rising costs of homelessness, both social costs and financial costs, an expectation from the electorate that councils provide housing, even though we know since 1980 that's been a very much reduced activity. And also because councils were wanting to just generate some activity in their local housing area, because their housing needs assessments were not matching up to the kinds of need assessment that the government required them to make, which was obviously much more focused on market housing. And of course, we know that there's a much greater need than just market housing. And of course, somebody's already asked a question about right to buy. Right to buy only applies in England. And some councils like Nottingham are losing the equivalent of one house a day, every day of the year, to right to buy as their stock dwindles. The second big reason actually though was planning was failing. So lots of renegotiation once planning consents had been given, councils trying to find ways to encourage starts on sites, long development periods, 40 years to build out major sites. And a lot of council leaders felt that they were taking the pain with local communities around delivery of new housing, which the government wanted, but sadly the developers weren't building at the same kind of rate. And lastly, there are lots of issues around councils wanting to support local businesses, small firms of architects, small builders, helping ex-offenders get back into work, and local apprenticeships. So I think the big first finding that we had was that every council was starting re-engaging in housing delivery, but for different reasons. So they all had their own reason, they were doing it their own way. So what did we find? Well, in 2017, 57% of English councils had a company. Those companies are all doing different things. Some are actually buying on the secondary market, some are developing, some like Brent are actually buying completed properties. But by our survey in 2019, we found that 78% of councils had companies. So we're seeing this now as a very much a bread and butter kind of approach, even though the companies were doing different things. 57% of councils had some form of joint venture. Some councils like joint ventures with housing associations, with private developers, with landowners, sometimes with other councils, some don't. And many councils like Slough, for example, have got a big joint venture for a major development of all types. They've got two of their own housing companies and they're still providing traditional housing revenue account, council housing. We also found that in the period between January 2018 and 2019, 119 new companies have been formed. Now, some councils are forming multiple companies. Some, like Hounslow, have 8 or 9, whereas Gateshead, for example, has one umbrella company and subsidiaries within it. So it counts as one company, but it's doing lots of different things. So there are lots of different ways these are being constructed. And what we also found is even where councils didn't have companies or joint ventures or a housing revenue account, many councils were still managing to deliver in their terms over 100 affordable and social rent houses, homes per year, using different kinds of relationships with different partners. So you don't need a company, a joint venture, or to be a housing revenue account authority to actually build on your general fund, and that's what, or purchase property on general fund. So you can just do it without any of those structures. But what's been successful? So just run through what we found particularly. So we found that those, and perhaps this, some of these won't be any surprise, but I think it's still important to reiterate them. So the first thing is that councils provide more housing where there's a corporate commitment to do so. And although people say, well, every council's in favour of providing housing, we actually found the councils that were delivering more were, this is really a kind of upfront issue, politically led, and one where almost the organisation is designed to deliver housing above everything else. So having that commitment is more than paying lip service to it. It has to have some practical manifestations. People have to see it, and the organisation has to understand that that's important. Obviously, for planners, the establishment of planning, the local plan and need in the local plan is difficult because obviously the government wants market housing as its priority. But we found many of our planners saying they had this huge discrepancy between their local needs assessments, which they're doing through a housing approach, and their housing needs assessments through a planning approach. And councils are trying to bridge this through their own development. What we found in planning also, that the delivery of housing needs to be a key issue in the negotiation for every development. So you can have fantastic policies, but unless you're actually negotiating them every time, then the policies really don't count for a great deal. And we found that this was a particular pressure point because planners in English planning departments have been very much cut down, and money's been taken away from the planning service, and therefore the pressure to negotiate housing and spend the time doing that can be set against other pressures for getting applications through on time. So time has to be taken to do that. But also we found those successful councils, where councils were successful in delivering, they were monitoring everything. They're monitoring every single site, they're monitoring all the interactions, and those sites are sites in every type of ownership. So what we found is that successful councils who were delivering had something like a customer relations management system, but for each housing site. So the whole history of every interaction, every communication, every piece of evidence around that site was in one place. And generally, councils who were successful were trying to ensure that the same officer was the main contact on that site, although that's not always possible. But having that kind of consistent approach is very helpful. We found many councils are now employing their own development surveyors with private sector experience, and they're funding this from the kind of funding they would have used for consultants on viability, and this is working very well. They have them all sorts of arrangements. They're having a lot of early retirees from the development sector, people from housing associations. They're sharing with other councils, they're taking them from their joint ventures, all sorts. But nevertheless, they're finding ways to get that expertise. Often they're creating housing delivery teams, multiple professionals coming together, whether they're architects, surveyors, planning, finance, legal, highways, and they just do everything on housing in those multiple teams. And that's having also an effect, which we haven't got the evidence for this, but it seemed to also be helping with job retention, so that people are really excited to be working on one of these multidisciplinary teams. The councils that were successful had housing delivery groups that met regularly, met with all their providers, and were very much always attempting to try to get rid of problems, deal with issues, provide bridging loans to deal with site issues, access, finding ways to take maybe some kind of interest in a development to get it moving. So there was a very proactive approach. And finally, I think, and very importantly, these successful councils had a housing delivery board that was chaired by a very senior politician. And that wasn't something, that board wasn't something that just met once in a while. In some councils, they meet weekly, and leading politicians want to know what's happening on every site, what the blockages are, what councils themselves can do to overcome delivery problems or meet housing need. So I hope what I've done is given you just a snapshot view of our research. There's lots more detail in the reports, and I hope that I've been able to share with you some of the practices of successful councils. These councils aren't yet meeting the kind of providing the numbers of homes that are needed, but nevertheless the numbers are going up all the time. And of course many councils started from a nil position and are just going back to this. So they're building up slowly, building back their teams, building their expertise. But I think they now, councils are seeing this as a mechanism for meeting housing need and indeed acting as patient investors, generating income. And there's a kind of win-win going on, and councils are now re-embracing this agenda. So I hope that's been helpful.
Brilliant. Thank you very much, Janet. I think one of the questions I'd like to come back to in the Q&A session a bit is that kind of richness of locally appropriate solutions that are being devised. How does that play out with, at the moment, a government with very centralising tendencies, and indeed the kind of the long history of housing policy, which has basically been you have a countrywide housing policy rather than lots of local ones. So something to come back to later. Thank you very much. And finally, in this first session, we have John O'Mahony. He's up in Northern Ireland today, although I understand he's a Kerryman, which is where I am today. He's one of Ireland's leading architects and master planners. And I think in a lot of the master planning work that he's going to illustrate, he has a really interesting insight about the interplay between good design, standards, zoning, space standards, viability, all the things that we kind of tussle with all the time, but with the benefit of having a kind of countrywide overview. I have already commended him on the selection of image on his opening slide, and he's going to have to wait until the end of the presentation to know just why I think it's such a great image. So over to you, John.
Thank you, Stephen. I'd like to talk about private sector housing regulation, delivery and affordability in Ireland. And I just want to do a sweep through what's been happening over the past few years. Before the recession of 2008, 90,000 homes were delivered in 2007 by a construction industry employing 250,000 workers. Affordability wasn't a problem, as loan-to-value ratios weren't pegged and profligate lending disguised the true cost of delivering apartments in particular. The form and quality of our housing has been diverging from its post-war model of sprawl to embrace a European model of master-planned, street-based, high-density neighbourhoods delivered in special development zones, their SDZs, which were legislated for in 2000. And currently, the largest regeneration urban expansion projects in the state are generally products of the SDZ planning design process. Adamstown on the screen was the first SDZ, and it was very much influenced by the suburb of Skarpnäck in Stockholm. Cherrywood, this is an image up on the screen, in South Suburban Dublin, references the finger plans of Copenhagen and its location, and the plan form of early Hammarby Sostadt, also in Stockholm. And as you can see, a lot of our references are European, and this example, which is the recent Poolbeg STZ in Dublin's Docklands, uses Nordhavn in Copenhagen as one of its models. The recession of 2008 was devastating to the Irish economy, with construction activity collapsing by 80%, and this continues to affect levels of housing delivery to the present day. For instance, housing completions in Adamstown, North Lots, Dublin, Docklands and Cherrywood, the three largest special development zones, are only now starting to accelerate, with 2,000 combined completions, which is quite low to date, from a possible 20,000 units. By 2012, the worst year of the recession, annual housing completions nationwide were down to 4,500 dwellings from the 90,000, and construction employment was down by 60%, and it hasn't recovered very much. Two things happened at this point, which impacted on housing delivery. Firstly, property investment funds arrived from Europe and America and started buying up property portfolios of bankrupted Irish developers. Over the next 8 years, virtually every large-scale private property development of significance was and continues to be funded with foreign investment money. A strictly domestically bank-funded housing market pre-recession is now an internationally funded housing market. This has impacted on the type and cost of housing in the state, which I'll come back to later. Secondly, in 2012, Dublin City Council introduced housing standards within its 2011 development plan, which had a serious impact on apartment viability. Dublin City Council regulations are generally set the standard and are followed by other urban executives. A requirement for 85% dual aspect units and a maximum of 6 units per core allied to maximum height caps of 5 and 6 floors in the city centre and in inner suburban areas seriously impacted viability. The intention was to protect the low-rise nature of the city. Unfortunately, the consequences of these changes were never scrutinised at the time or challenged, as we were all dead and buried as far as consultation was concerned. As the economy recovered, a serious housing shortage was manifest in most cities, but particularly in Dublin. In 2016, the government published Rebuilding Ireland, its policy for tackling the housing crisis. It was a very comprehensive and well-intentioned document aimed at eliminating homelessness, increasing public and private housing supply, modernising the public and private rental sectors in particular. The €6 billion plan proposed to increase annual housing completions from the 7,200 in 2015 to 25,000 in 2020, and to provide 50,000 new built council homes by 2021. National apartment regulations, which had been first published in 2007, were revised to allow greater flexibility in apartment typologies and mix, increase in numbers of units per core and reduction in dual aspect ratios to combat what had been happening up to now. Reduced car parking standards are mandated, and in particular regulation of the corporate managed build-to-rent sector was introduced, as were regulations covering the sort of nascent shared living model. This is dubbed in the press as student accommodation for adults. At the same time, in 2016, the Society of Chartered Surveyors of Ireland issued a report titled The Real Cost of New Housing Delivery, which showed that the cost of building and servicing a house or an apartment in Ireland amounted to approximately 48% of the total sales price. The balance comprised land costs, developers' margin, finance costs, local authority contributions, and professional fees. However, it was estimated that over 30% of the price of a house returned to the exchequer in the form of taxation, VAT at 13.5% being the single biggest contributor. VAT on construction in the UK is zero. More worryingly for high density development, it found that the price of a traditional two-bed apartment in a lift-served apartment development of any kind in virtually any area of the country was unaffordable for the average couple on an average combined income trying to raise a mortgage under current central bank loan-to-value regulations. The government itself carried out an unpublished viability study in 2018, and it drew exactly the same conclusions, hence it was never published. A study by the Housing Agency, which is a government-based research body, compared Irish building costs with our European neighbours and found them to be comparable. So construction costs weren't necessarily seen to be at the heart of the problem. A raft of regulation, policy and strategy changes followed the publication of Rebuilding Ireland, aimed at trying to close the viability gap. It included the National Planning Framework, which was a 10-pillar new strategic 20-year plan for Ireland. But the very first item was compact growth. And what it did was to change the direction from greenfield development to restraining our city's growth and highlighting brownfield and regeneration as being the critical first element in development of our cities. The national height regulations were published, which mandated more flexibility on building heights and typologies, promoting sustainable development through the application of minimum density policies. The Land Development Agency was set up to develop state lands, and John will be talking to you about that after me. And probably the most contentious Rebuilding Ireland initiative was the launching in 2018 of a fast-track temporary system of planning approval called the Strategic Housing Development Process, the SHD for short. It will expire in 2021 and is structured to fast-track the approval of housing developments of over 100 units by appointing the Appeals Board in Borplanola as the sole decision-maker. The process is intended to reduce the average decision-making time frame for large-scale housing developments from 82 weeks to 32 weeks. And so now, in 2020, what's the housing situation following all of these initiatives? Results 5 years after launching Rebuilding Ireland are patchy at most. Demand has expanded to a need for probably a minimum of about 35,000 units per annum. That may be even 50,000 if inwards migration continues at the pre-COVID levels. And our delivery is just around 23,000. The Rebuilding Ireland target for council housing was almost met, but primarily through procurement from the private sector, and homelessness is still an unresolved problem in our cities. In our practice, we did a comparative study on the apartment regulations between 2011 and 2018 to see if the changes had made any great difference. And we discovered that yes, apartment development was improved by 30% in terms of capacity. And the number of cores needed, which is the most expensive element, had reduced from 12 to 4. And also the relaxed housing restrictions significantly increased site capacity. The build-to-rent model for housing dominates the private market. However, 4% returns on investment are attractive to investment in investors in a no-interest environment. Also, Irish developers have no capital after the recession, and bank lending is expensive. Therefore, the risk-free upfront development funding and purchasing of high-density apartment projects by corporate rental landlords is too attractive a proposition to ignore. The affordability gap mentioned earlier makes building for sale very unattractive except in upmarket locations. And 80% of my practice's projects in the past 3 years have been built-to-rent projects. Regarding the SHD planning process, in the first 2 years, approximately 12,500 homes and 7,500 student accommodation units were approved, and timeframes for delivery decisions have dramatically improved. However, in the absence of a third-party appeal system, judicial review procedures, court procedures, are now being widely employed by third parties to overturn decisions, which in turn leads to delays in development and delivery. And also, only about a quarter of approved projects have proceeded to site to date. Suburban intensification has also been met with fierce local opposition from politicians and local residents. Height is a very contentious issue, even at modest 5 to 6 story levels. Virtually all housing developments are now subject to the threat of judicial review. Also, the media and the public are still angry with developers for, as they see it, bankrupting the country in 2008. And regard new house building models such as build-to-rent housing or shared living as international vulture funds, as they call them, profiteering and excluding the possibility of delivering sustainable, affordable purchase housing in our cities. One opposition political party is proposing legislation to ban shared living as a model of housing in Ireland. So what to do? The private sector just cannot deliver affordable, high-density private housing without some form of government intervention, either by subsidy on the supply side to reduce the tax take, or shared ownership and or possibly cost rental funding models on a grand scale on the demand side. Dramatic action on land values also needs to be enacted. either through possible windfall taxation, which is not attractive, on excessive profit, or government involvement in the sale of land. I think John Coleman may have something to say about that. Government must take direct responsibility for delivering social and affordable housing, something that hasn't been happening for the last 20 years. Currently, the view is that the Land Development Agency is the best vehicle to make that happen in an efficient and timely way. Repurpose the planning system to replicate the best elements of the temporary SHD system and take the courts out of the planning decision-making process. Introduce a use it or lose it condition to large scale development to ensure speedy delivery. Also properly resource the planning authorities as part of the COVID dividend to accelerate the recovery of the construction industry and to deliver more houses. Educate the politicians and the population on the reasons for densification, the methods for assessing quality, and the properly engage with stakeholders, not just pay lip service to it. Prepare three-dimensional long-term master plans of our suburban areas, showing sustainable opportunities for densification, which is where increases in numbers will most happen. And finally, architects to embrace the challenge of designing innovative, standardized, affordable models of high density apartments and walk-up apartments, and the application of modular supply construction methods across all density categories, which we see in areas like Finland and Scandinavia. Thank you.
Great, John. Thank you very much indeed. Bang on time. Would the other panelists like to, the other two speakers like to come in for this next session? Just the first kind of response to, as we've only got 10 minutes, I'll pick up things that have been coming through the thread, and for the second Q&A session at the end, hopefully we'll have a bit more time to ask questions to come in directly. But John, I think you were describing something that feels very familiar to us in London, the same kind of international capital flows into the city, driving build to rent. But it seems to me that one of the fascinating things about COVID, and I speak as a land economist, which is my kind of training, is that investors of all kinds, and that means home investors as well, have to reimagine what rent means. Quite suddenly, people can't pay rent. And you know, rent wasn't something that just grew on trees to which investors were entitled. It's a function of a well-working economy. So if the nature of the economy changes, some of our ideas about rent also have to change, I think. And similarly, political parties, no names, that continue to promote home ownership as the kind of ideal. Home ownership implies, for most people, taking on quite a substantial amount of debt, which in turn assumes stable employment with regular incomes and predictable incomes, none of which now apply. Peter, how do you respond to that?
Yes, interesting. The idea of rent as a, if you like, an economic good. Yes, that's fine. I mean, I don't want to get into the sort of complexities of rent theory, Stephen, which could tie us up for the rest of the day. Indeed. But I do think what we're seeing now is a real amplification of what has actually been incipient market failure for a long time. I think COVID just pushed it over the edge. And it's quite interesting that one of the things that I'm actively pursuing at the moment is looking at obtaining permission to start purchasing surplus office and commercial floor space to convert into social homes. And as you know, it doesn't take any imagination to realize that the market at the moment is fairly open to people like ourselves actually arguing the case for social and affordable housing in some of that surplus commercial space. Oh. So I think certainly investors need to reconfigure what they see as their risk profiles. It's interesting that I've got investment funds saying to me that social and affordable housing is actually now becoming a very attractive proposition. Why? Well, because quite a high percentage of the tenants are in receipt of benefit, and at least they'll be sure that part, maybe 80% of their rent gets paid. So I think there's some interesting realignment, Stephen, taking place. And if you actually, Adam Smith would love this, if you look at the dynamics of an economy, then the invisible guiding hand is pushing us back to the position where some of the people who have discovered that they are in a position where they can't afford rent are now having their expectations recalibrated, both from a user side and a supplier side. So, yeah, I think there's a very interesting adjustment taking place. Okay. I think it actually has been kicking around since 2008.
Yeah.
And I think we've had this mini boom. I was appalled in 2014. The Financial Times condemned one of the major mortgage providers for saying things are really getting back to normal now. We're getting people with 90% loan-to-value mortgages. We're not worrying about people's true income. We're taking self-declarations, and I'm thinking, oh my God, have we learned nothing from 6 years of misery? And it's taken this second wave of misery to actually just hammer home some fundamental points. Stephen, you were probably like me, trained as a Keynesian, so I welcome this. It's good.
Yeah.
Stephen, just a quick update. Yesterday, Deloitte issued a report about rental housing sector in the Republic, and it pointed out that there's now this difficulty, this COVID difficulty, that with huge increases in unemployment, etc., that those high rental levels are now being challenged. And another couple of interesting things is the appearance, for instance, of an affordable housing REIT, which I think is a really interesting proposition. And already since in the last 2 months, I've been approached by two developers who are looking specifically at affordable housing development at high density. And they're looking at it on the basis of a longer term return than even the 4% return. And they're almost looking at it, it's very hard to put the word Christian, caring, thoughtful, and developer into the same sentence. But there is certainly an appearance of looking at a longer term affordable rental model. In the South, our problem is that there's about 2 million homes and just 260,000 apartments. So, and yet up to 60% of households don't require 3-bedroom family houses with front and back gardens. So there's a whole change. We have to start making apartment living attractive for the greater population.
I'm discussing with people about there's already a social, not just affordable, John, there's a social housing gap,
which has been established. Yes.
So, These are rent takers willing to take on rental levels, which are 50% of market rent. That's where we are. I mean, my view is squeeze them. I'm sorry. I don't feel sorry. I've got to run a flag day for these people. Just take it.
I just want to bring in Janice here. The point I made earlier about the kind of the development of lots of local solutions, which of course run entirely counter to what John has been describing, with international capital flows coming into place, which in a sense then determine the kind of rental or home ownership product that's being developed. How do you think locally driven solutions can roll back the international forces or even national forces when national policies also seem to be rather inappropriate right across the country?
I think firstly, the government's been a bit distracted with Brexit. Secondly, I think it's everybody's recognised, including volume house builders, that they can never build the 300,000 plus homes required and brackets. They don't have any intention of doing that either. I think that local politicians have realised that the products being provided by the private sector, space standards, thinking about carbon reduction, they're all design, layout. These are all, no matter how hard they try to control them through the local authority, these are really, in some cases, you've got new build flats going straight to buy to let and never really establishing any community and almost going to, you know, being the first occupiers and that sort of dumping fridges, you know, within a very short period of time, dumping stuff outside. So I think what councils are doing is actually trying to meet the gaps in their own market. So, for example, up in the northeast, we've got councils who are actually building executive homes because the market won't provide them, because they don't think there is a market for executive homes in that bit of the northeast. Whereas that council, and I won't say which it is, sees its own people in households in that category moving to neighbouring areas. So they're actually trying to meet that demand. You've got Nottingham intervening where there's studentification. So what they're doing is they've actually stabilised the population. They've put investment into shops so that areas can stay mixed and not just become, you know, single type. And then, you know, why? And the government would like councils to build more through housing revenue accounts, and obviously took the debt cap off. But because right to buy remains, I'm not saying councils aren't looking at using it, but for very specific purposes. So, for example, Bromley Council in London is just about to reopen an HRA, but it is actually very much focused on homelessness, on the homelessness end of the issue, not just basic housing. So councils, many of them have set up companies that don't have a name that reflects the council name, because they thought people wouldn't want to, say, buy or rent from councils, you know, for that council housing issue. And so what they've done is they've called them another name, but people locally find out. And in Wolverhampton, for example, at the first release of the housing that the council had built, at a housing fair, people were queuing around the block before it opened to buy these houses that the council had provided, because they know they're better space standards, they're better layout, in, you know, better design. Councils are building passive homes, Exeter, you know, all sorts of things are going on, which are experimentation, innovation, but also a mechanism for generating income and meeting housing need. And I think, as the last speaker said, generating income from affordable homes is a very stable income. And Westminster City Council, that block just by Paddington, you must know it, Stephen, yeah. They're generating just from affordable and market rents in a mix, tenant mix, they're generating £3 million a year towards the general fund to run other services. That's just in one housing block.
Right, thank you. I always think that the phrase, global intelligence is informed by local knowledge, is really important, is that we really need all these kind of local examples, and they're really important ways of showing different ways of how things can be done. I'm going to have to move on to the next section now. Thank you very much to our three speakers from this morning session. We're going to move on to John Coleman, just give him a moment to kind of get set up. Just from the some of the things that were in the chat earlier on, things I'd like to come back to in the final session. There was a great question from Henry Ogunjobi. How can housing be made a justiciable human right? I think is a really important question. Sally Starbuck raising some issues about energy costs, but there's a kind of whole wider issue about sustainable buildings and also to do with kind of high buildings, which we know consume more energy and emit more carbon per square meter once you get over six floors. I think there's kind of a whole range of issues around why are we going on building homes that we already know are obsolete the day they're occupied, when we know they're going to have to be retrofitted by 2050, by which time we will be in a zero carbon economy. So I'd now like to invite John Coleman chief executive of the Land Development Agency. John was described in our warm up session yesterday as the Messiah, somebody who's going to have all the answers about how you ramp up housing supply in Ireland. Of course, the clue is in the name, the Land Development Agency. If you don't have the land, you can't do anything. So John's job is to find ways of bringing land forward on large scale, but also matching that with appropriate forms of capital, and possibly not the sort of things that John O'Mahony was talking about this morning. So over to you, John Coleman.
Thanks very much, Stephen, and hello to everyone. And my thanks to the Academy, and particularly to Tony Reddy and to Olga for having me here to speak today. It's an honor, and it's very good for me to present to you. I'm going to just try and share my screen here, and please do shout if I'm unsuccessful in that. So hopefully you can see that. So the three things that I'd like to talk about today really is just to tell you a little bit about the LDA and what it is. And thanks, Stephen, for the low expectation setting on the intro there. I feel no pressure at all. And I just know today that one of the opposition parties in Ireland has released a statement to say that the LDA is not the solution to the housing crisis. Maybe we're not the entire solution, but I'd like to think that we can play a significant role.
I'm really sorry for interrupting, but we cannot see a full screen. Can you change the display settings?
Okay.
John, I have a copy of your presentation. Just give me a shout if you want me to drive it for you.
Okay. I will try once more. Just bear with me. Yeah, please, if you wouldn't mind driving for me, I'd appreciate it. It's just that I seem to be
up now.
Cooperating here. That's great, thank you very much. So some of the things that I'd like to talk to you about, just to tell you a bit about the LDA, and as I say, look, we're not a panacea by any means, but I'd like to think that we're going to play a reasonably significant role in addressing the housing issue that we have, particularly around affordability. The second thing I'll mention is just the wider policy and the long-term strategic basis for the LDA. And then thirdly, specifically in terms of direct housing delivery, what are we doing for affordable housing? And so if I can move on to the next slide, please. And the affordable housing, because it's really key for the LDA. We have very significant expectations from our government stakeholders to assist and to focus on affordable housing. And it's not just as a social justice measure, which is important in its own right, but it also has significant knock-on benefits, including prosperity and labour mobility, which is represented quite well in this quote that we've taken from the McKinsey Institute. So I think it's there's a number of reasons why the LDA would get involved in affordable housing. Next slide, please, and the one after that. So what are we? I guess really in simple terms is to make development happen when and where it should be happening, and to do that by making more land available for development, and to go a step further and to ensure that it gets developed. And John O'Mahony raised an interesting point, I thought, in his presentation, stating that a quarter of approved projects for the fast track planning process in Ireland have yet to come to site. So it's not enough just to have planning frameworks or strategies for that. It's just to have a practical input into making things happen once a plan is put in place. So we hope to do that by unlocking land and making things happen on that land. Next slide, please. So we exist at the moment. There's an LDA bill, which we hope will turn into an act by the end of 2020. We've some money available to us which is transferred from a sovereign, Irish Sovereign Wealth Fund, ISIF. It won't be enough, so we will have to look at other ways to attract funding, and I'll talk to that later on as well. We have about 40 on the team now at the moment. We have a place in Dublin that we're operating from, albeit remotely at the moment, and we hope to have a wider operating basis throughout the country later on in 2020. Next slide, please. So we're reseeded with 8 sites, which can generate around 4,000 homes. We have a 100% social and affordable scheme that we're working on with Dunleary Rathdown County Council in Shangana, and which is in South Dublin, a reasonably nice area in South Dublin. So we are setting our stall out in terms of our focus on particularly affordable housing with that particular one. We hope to increase the scale of the land bank to about 10,000 by the end of the year and about 20,000 by the following year. So we're in scale up mode at the moment. We should have construction starting next year on some sites, and we are considering how do we launch our affordable housing initiatives in the country. There's no dedicated affordable housing platforms, albeit some being talked about, as John O'Mahony mentioned again. But really, we see an opportunity to lead on that. Next slide, please. So in sum, our general direction is really two things. It's to open up land, and it's to provide better housing choices. And all of the objectives that we set ourselves are leading towards that, and which, again, will hopefully, over the long term, result in development happening where and when it should be happening. Next slide, please. So, and next again. So when I think about the RIAI, why were we set up? And there's a couple of illustrations from a 2014 KPMG and Shelter report around land prices and the focus of the market on land and the focus of competition on land. So if you start at the bottom right, we have a housing market, and depending on the cycle, that can be buoyant, which in turn drives land prices and speculation on land and asset values, which in turn concentrates development into the hands of relatively few players. And you probably see that in the UK, where SME firms pre-global financial crisis developed about 2/3 of all housing, whereas that, and 1/3 developed by the large PLCs, and that has reversed through the crash, given the PLCs greater access to capitalization, which has the effect of reducing competition. Then you have a vicious cycle flowing again into the housing market, driving land values and creating barriers to entry for new competitors in the building market. Next slide, please. So that puts a lot of competition into the land market. We've seen that in Ireland when 2012, when you could barely give land away, it was a liability almost, to the point where it's actually quite highly valued more recently, particularly in key urban locations. So that's where the competition, to all intents and purposes, happens. In the Irish context, we've only a handful of large developers, 2 or 3, you could even say. And so you have the bigger firms are able to outcompete SMEs because the development is concentrated in the larger firms. And so the competition isn't on the development side there. And then further on to that, you have relatively high cost housing that is partially driven by some interventions that happen, which are demand side subsidies rather than supply side subsidies. So you prefer for less competition to be happening in the land market, and in other words, for more of it to be made available. Next slide, please. So when we think about how do we tackle that issue, well, in terms of making more land available, we looked at a number of European schemes, including Vinex in the Netherlands, which kind of came a proper because they made some poor financial decisions towards the end of its tenure, but its effect is undeniable. It increased the Dutch housing stock by around 7% over 15 years. It was a planning policy akin to what we have for strategic development zones in this country. However, it went further. It involved local authorities and government agencies taking a step into the development side to bring together players to form land pooling partnerships and to make sure that the development piece happens. So it's not, again, not just a planning policy. Next slide, please. So some of the models that they had there were that areas were designated like we have with SDZs, but they went further to pool land through joint ventures. So we don't have 10 or 12 different actors within a wider strategic space, not acting in unison. The land value helped finance infrastructural needs, which is another issue we have in many SDZs that we have in this country, of which I think, you know, I think there are, the stats are, there's roughly 30,000 housing units that could be developed on these SDZs, but only about a tenth of those have been delivered to date. And it's to see, can we mobilize land value as well to unlock some of that. CPO power is much talked about with the LDA as well, but we'd like to think of that as the kind of inducement to cooperation and to collaboration rather than something that you would deploy liberally. Next slide, please. So that's the wider strategic context, and we obviously are working on that in the long term. And we actually have a couple of nascent strategic areas that we're working on in Limerick and Galway that will hopefully help refine and improve the model there. But in terms of direct housing delivery, particularly affordable housing delivery, we also have a focus on that, particularly with our nearer term land bank that we have access to. Next slide, please. So why does the LDA have a role in affordable delivery? Well, our mandate is set by the Parliament, the Oireachtas. There's a clear political focus on the delivery of affordable housing, and I know that's a focus of our Minister in the Department of Housing. So hence, we are owned by the state, and we are certainly geared towards affordable delivery. But the challenge with that is that we don't have an affordable housing sector in Ireland. We haven't fully defined what affordable housing is yet, especially rental. What's an affordable rent? What platforms operate? What platforms finance them? Where does the money come from? And I think money is out there, as John again mentioned, in terms of private sector interest in this space. But there's a bit of a chicken and egg, because private sector tends to be interested in scale. So you could get European operators who operate hundreds of thousands of units in Europe will come to you in Ireland and say with a straight face, we need minimum 5,000 to 10,000 units to be interested. And that in the Irish context is a huge number. So I think we have to play a role in getting an affordable housing industry and sector to scale in the country. And how do we do that? We can utilize state lands to do that. So that's our overall strategy. Next slide, please. We're particularly focused on a rental model. So that's particularly cost rental. So we would take the cost of provision. We would make land available cheaply or at nominal cost. We put in long-term debt structures, and we provide long-term security of occupancy for the tenants. And we're hoping that we can create a financially sustainable and an investable proposition there that can be scaled and that can be even delivered through downturns in the market as well. So, and at the same time, deliver an affordable rent. Next slide, please. So we could be able to gather state lands and local authority partnerships that I've mentioned earlier on to create that platform. And I think a marked success of this will be if other platforms were created too off the back of it, as this being a catalyst, and then to produce homes let over the long term and long term security for tenants at levels that are affordable. Next slide, please. So affordability is a complex question. We're doing a bit of research around this area. You talk to some people, they would tell you 600-700 a month is affordable. Talk to others and they tell you it's higher than that. So we're doing a bit of research around that space. But next slide, please. But where we're coming to is that we're really targeting the people that don't qualify for social housing supports, but that struggle to afford private sector rents. And when that's really the middle 3 to 4 deciles of income in the country, when you look at the numbers there in terms of net income availability to service and accommodation cost, to land somewhere in the middle of that would be an aspiration for the LDA. And we think there's a very large target market in the Irish context of in excess of 120,000 households that would benefit from this form of tenure. So that's really what we're targeting when we talk about affordable housing. Next slide, please.
John, you need to finish quite quickly.
Maybe there. The financial sustainability is critical. There's two approaches. One thing we often forget as European union members is state aid is a consideration, and some of the case studies and case law doesn't help us. So we must act in a sustainable and financially sustainable way and be comparable to the market. Next slide, please. But look, lots of challenges, but we should overcome for the benefits. Next slide, thanks. So just to summarize on the next slide, So we have two clear objectives. We want to increase land supply in the longer term strategic basis, but we want to bring forward direct affordability initiatives that can benefit in the long term. And really where we want to get to is to drive scale and to help drive scale. And I think if we drive scale, there are real policy options for the state in terms of bringing in wider affordability requirements akin to Section 106 in the UK on land. That doesn't exist, but we need those platforms there to take it off. So that's it from me. Thanks very much. And sorry for going over time.
Okay, thank you very much, John. Sorry to hurry you at the end there. Thank you very much. I mean, it feels as if there are real opportunities at a national level to kind of recalibrate investor expectations and means of production, things of that kind. But if you kind of look back over the chat thread while you've been speaking, there's quite a lot of emphasis on more locally appropriate solutions and kind of anxiety about kind of large scale investors building stuff that's not appropriate to particular places. Obviously, that kind of feeds into the opposition that new developments are getting. Okay, thank you very much. I'm going to move swiftly on to Sue Riddlestone. Sue is somebody who has lived what she preaches, being a founder member of Bioregional and living in the BEDZ scheme, which was their first development. She's a great advocate of various forms of community-led housing, a lot of which revolve around how you capture and tame the damaging effects of speculation in land. So Sue, over to you.
Okay. Thanks, Stephen. I'm just going to share my screen. Can everyone see that okay?
Yep, good.
Good. So today I'm going to briefly introduce what we do at Bioregional, and then I'm going to share with you a more sort of social enterprise, grassroots, community-led approach that we're taking to work to create affordable housing, so ways and means of affordable housing. So first of all, we're a charity. We've won awards for being a social enterprise. We're based in the UK, but we work internationally too. And we've been working for 25 years, mainly around environmental sustainability, but also sustainability in its most holistic sense, in the built environment, in business, for products. We've worked with companies like B&Q, and in cities and regions working with local government. And we partner to build our own developments. This is BEDZ, where I'm speaking from today. It's a 100 home mixed use eco village in London, where I live, and something that I'm still a guinea pig and learning from day in and day out, including that we've got a lot more private rental here, and it has had an effect on the community spirit. But anyway, we're working on that. And also projects like One Brighton, where we're showing that we can build sustainable homes within the normal range of build costs. And our work on these award-winning projects has led to us also doing a lot of advisory work. So we've worked with big name clients and on projects like the London 2012 Olympics, where we wrote the sustainability strategy and then worked on delivery. And then with local authorities like Lambeth, where we help with sustainability and planning applications. And we're working on projects in Ireland too, such as the Augustine Bay in Galway. We always use our One Planet Living framework, which is based on 10 principles. And we developed it to systematize our approach following BEDZ, because so many people came to us and said, can you help us to do a BEDZ? And today it's used for about 30 billion of real estate development around the world. And so we've always been working on sustainability and creating community. And I just want to re-emphasize, I know John said it, Peter said it, I think everybody's mentioned it, but we're in a climate and ecological emergency, and all new homes need to be built to enable zero carbon and sustainable living. So that's really important. And it's also an affordability issue. We have found that sustainable living leads to better mental and physical health outcomes, and it can save you money. So it's affordable living as well as affordable housing. And for example, cycling and walking is cheaper than using a car. Sharing instead of buying means you save money and you meet neighbours. Lower resource use means lower bills. and it saves us all money on the NHS too. So that's a win-win situation in the big scheme of things. So please don't forget this important element in your work. But back to today's key topic of affordability. So we started working on this as we realised what a big issue it was in housing for the sort of squeezed middle, as we would call it, of younger people who are in work. They're kind of stuck as generation rent. It's very insecure when they start to have families and then suddenly the landlord says, oh, you've got to move out. It's really disruptive. And it's also when people want to settle down, if they feel like they don't want that burden of being forced on all the time, then they might have to move away. So it's happened to me. My daughter has moved to Bracknell, 30 miles away. I don't have a car, so I have to hire a car when I want to go and see her. So the trains is not a good idea at the moment. She's newly pregnant. I'm going to go over and help her on Friday. And it split us apart, you know, this unaffordability. You can't just hop in and look after each other. And, you know, people are commuting long distances. And you can see here on this slide how out of step house prices are with average net family income, especially around this younger generation who wants to settle down, and especially in the southeast. So I'm not talking about social housing. I'm talking about affordable housing in a different context, which was something that Peter mentioned at the beginning. So we do focus on London and the southeast, where house and land prices are high. And we spent 2 years trying to figure out how to do this with like-minded organisation, Transition by Design. And Charlie Fisher is on the call in the audience today. He's actually doing a PhD on the subject. So hope he poses some questions and joins in. And we also worked at the took advice at the time from Stephen Hill, our chair, who also has a huge amount of experience in this area. So in 2018, we set up Bioregional Homes, which is a wholly owned company of the charity. And we got started with developing the model and the pipeline. And in June this year, we secured a delivery partner, Hill Residential. And, you know, we like them because they share our values. They're actually building modular homes for homeless people, which are cheaper and really interesting to local authorities. And so they want to work with us to build sustainable homes that are affordable. So I'm going to explain how we go about this by means of a case study of our sort of lead-in project in Chobham. So it's 30 homes. Chobham is a village in Surrey on the outskirts of London. It's very much the commuter belt. The scale of homes that we like to look at is about at the minimum of 20 to 30, because we want to create a community, but also there's an economy of scale. So that's sort of the lower end. So 30 is a bit of a sweet spot. And it means that you can see this site, it's on the edge of the village settlement, but there's houses either side of it. And so it's a good place to build. But the first thing we realised was that we can't compete on land with the big developers, which has come up in all the presentations. They just bid up the prices higher than what is actually viable at the moment, because they know they can just bank it and there's no penalty if they get their planning permission, which takes ages. And by the time it comes around, they can pick and choose which sites to develop. So we look for land which is not on the open market, or landowners who want to use their land for a legacy project that they can be proud of. And in this case, the landowner is a family who care about environmental issues and they still live in the community, so they want to do right. And the grandparents had a garden nursery, the land is derelict. It's zoned in the council's plan to come forward for development in the next 5 years, but it's in the green belt, the whole village is, so that means it's called a rural exception site. And in England, this means that it can't be sold on the open market for housing as yet, but it could be used for affordable homes. And for this, it would need to prioritise rules around local people first, which we wholeheartedly agree with. So we're not a registered social housing provider, nor do we plan to be. So we need to develop the homes like a regular developer, buy the land, build it and sell it. So we went for a discount market sale model where the discount is secured through a covenant on that land. And the land trust owns the land, and then people who live there are members as well as locally elected representatives. And when householders want to sell, they need to get the price verified by three local agents, and then they have to sell for the same discount against today's prices and to local people first. And we work to come up with a sort of checklist of what were the criteria for living there, including local and work connections and so on. And so the local people are empowered to do this. And as we evaluate each site, we base our viability case on local median household income for people in work. And we took a third of income. That was something that you mentioned, John, as a measure of what's affordable. And then we use that to determine the price of the land, which is interesting. And we spent a long time trying to figure this out. As I say, we took advice from Stephen. We visited other projects. The Lilac development in Leeds is a great example, which has its own particular sort of mortgage type model. And we worked with Charlie Fisher, who's on the call today. Next, thinking about working with the community. So sometimes we're approached by a community group, and there are over 300 community land trusts in England and Wales, and there are more than 800 community-led housing groups in total, and a pipeline which was estimated this summer by Dr. Tom Archer of around 23,000 homes. And there is even a national community land trust organisation and network, so it's quite well established. With lots of sort of lawyers who are expert in it, and it's a well-known thing, and it's actually practiced very widely in the States. And sometimes our route is the landowners, and in this case, as it was landowner first, we approached the local people, local councillors, community organisations to engage with them early on and promoted the idea. We also checked the local housing needs survey. In this case, we had to actually commission one by the Rural Housing Enabler to establish the need and demand and evidence our case to the local authority. Then we secured an interest on the site that we would buy it if we secured planning permission, sort of an option. And that meant we could begin work on the planning application, and the community worked with us on the design. I was looking for a picture of it. I'm sorry I couldn't find one. But anyway, here's their post-it notes of what people wanted. So we have people who wanted to live there. Some of them came off the custom build register, which is a policy in England, possibly Wales, I'm never quite sure which rules apply to which nation, but that's for people who want to design their own homes a bit, as well as they can't afford a home. So community people who want to live there, as well as people who just need a home, worked with us. So we got a good design with working with the community and top architects, Sterling Price shortlisted all Thistleton architects. You can see here, it's a very wooded site, so we've kept the home for nature as well as a home for people by making it a bit more dense and neighbourly than the local authority tend to require around there. And we've got a plan that shows 70% of homes to be affordable.
Couple of minutes.
Sorry? Okay. So, but we did face some challenges. How do you fund planning applications? It's £150,000 at least for a planning application. All the studies you have to get done, all the design work. So we went out and raised impact investment loans, and we got a loan from the Charities Aid Foundation. The UK government did have a scheme where they were, after much years of lobbying, they were actually supporting this sector. And then, just as is typical with this government and this flavour of government, sorry to get political, all these, you know, they scrap policies which people build up over years, and it's been scrapped. So that is something you could maybe look at in those other nations where you've got more freedom to act. We also had an issue with the planning process. We actually finished designing this 2 years ago. We've been stuck in the planning system ever since. First of all, the officer kept pushing it back and asking for changes. I think at the bottom of it was some neighbours objecting to any homes being built next door to them. And then, oh, there's my alarm. And then also the social housing provider officer saying, I just want regular social housing. I don't understand this weird stuff, but we are fully compliant with planning policy. So we've gone to appeal, and we hope that we'll win the appeal. So in conclusion, I'm very proud that we've got this great project to be proud of, and we've got this good case at appeal. But in a nutshell, here's our model: land off the open market, lower cost land, discount market sale model with some full market price homes to cost subsidise, a community land trust with covenants on the land to maintain the discounts, and that also gets around the right to buy issue. And to enable it to flourish, we need people like us who are all on this call to work with communities as kind of a nice developer or paid advisor. We need funding for making planning applications, which could be repayable, and we need politicians and planning departments to support us and not stand in our way. Thank you very much. Sorry for going a minute over.
Yep, that's lovely. Thank you very much, Sue. Yeah, and let's hear it for the nice developers. there are some around. Okay, thank you very much. And just to reassure you a little bit, I'm not sure the government actually did anything as active as scrapping the Community Housing Fund. It just forgot to renew it, which is slightly different. And we hope that they are responding to the pressure that's now being put on them. As one minister did say, I get an awful lot of mail from MPs about the Community Housing Fund. So it does register. Okay, so our final speaker this morning, and just to warn you that we're running about 10 minutes late, so we plan to extend the Q&A session, so we're not going to lose that to 10 past 12, but if you have to go at 12, I'm sorry, you'll miss the extra 10 minutes. So Ewan, welcome from Scotland, and also thank you for standing in at such short notice. Ewan is an architect who set up a practice called N7. Perhaps you'd explain what N7 is, and what that is. You're going to talk to us about a rather amazing estate regeneration scheme. So over to you.
Thank you very much. Let me just share the screen. Right, can you see the screen?
Yes.
Good, okay, right, I'll get going. I'm going to talk to you about our Fraser Avenue regeneration project. It's in Brickheaving, near Edinburgh. Our practice, which is 7N, North London postcode, we've been involved for the past 7 years or so. And I want to talk to you about our experience and the lessons that come from that, and particularly lessons that come from that in terms of the softer side of placemaking. And what I mean by softer side, I mean basically the non-physical side, the people really, people who were involved in the project and who made it happen, and the lengths they went to make it the success that's been recognised for. And in a way, I suppose, looking at the title, Build Better, Live Better, this is definitely looking at the live better side, perhaps the other end of the telescope from the some of the policy discussions, but equally important, as I'm sure everybody would agree. But first of all, some orientation. There we go. Fraser Avenue is in Inverkeithing, just north of Edinburgh on the Firth of Forth. And you can see from this photograph, this is Fraser Avenue here. This is the original Fraser Avenue estate, which was built in the 1950s. So you can see the bridges, these fine bridges, give you some orientation. Latterly, in this 20th century, the settlement was really focused around really ship breaking in and around that inlet you can see in the photograph, and that provided a lot of the jobs in the area, and that the workers who were employed there and the families who were really the original residents of Fraser Avenue. So it was built in the 1950s as part of the post-war housing boom. This is council housing. It was built by Fife Council. But like many of these places, which are built on a wave of positive hope for the future, it's really suffered during the latter part of the 20th century for a whole range of well-documented reasons. Many of those are physical, but a lot of them are softer issues to do with management policies as well. It is very familiar issues with the architecture of that period in terms of lots of undefined space, very little sense of ownership, belonging, lots of well ambiguous shared space, which ended up not being cared for by anybody. But although it started off extremely well. And by the 1980s, when this photograph was taken, it was very much in a state of decline. I would ask you to look at the shops on the right-hand side and see the signboards, because I'll come back to that later in this. But certainly by the beginning of the 21st century, it was in the top 15% of the most deprived areas in Scotland. Most of the residents were on benefits of one form or another, and I think it's fair to say that Fraser Avenue was in a spiral decline, which was almost impossible to get out of without some kind of game-changing move. And it got to the point where it had become stigmatized within the wider community in Bakering. People who didn't live there tended not to go there, and many people who lived there didn't want to say that they actually lived there. So this kickstarted a regeneration initiative around 2011, led by Fife Council. They were looking for ideas to regenerate Fraser Avenue, and that's when we got involved and we won a competitive process to initially do master planning. And jumping ahead, this is the master plan you can see on screen at the moment. I'm going to tell you a bit about the master plan, but actually the most interesting bit about Fraser Avenue, I think, having been involved with it over the years, is actually Fraser Avenue is fundamentally a people story. So amidst all of the deprivation and the negativity around the area, there was a strong core of people who cared passionately about the place and wanted to make it a better place. So I think the key thing was when this was aligned with the enthusiasm and commitment the Kingdom Housing Association brought to the project, when they took over the running of the estate from the council and a stock transfer, which happened about a year into the master planning process. And I think, although I'd like to claim some credit for the work our practice has done on the master plan, I think the real game changer here, the thing that's really made the difference, is the way the Kingdom Housing Association actually drove the project so positively and got involved engagement at all levels, all the way through. I think that's the number one thing that's made the difference to the success of the project. So although we did extensive engagement as part of the master planning process, which we've done a lot of, we actually did this with Nick Wright Planning, we do a lot of work with them in Scotland. I'm not going to suggest that going through an engagement process with pictures, colored post-its on the board is anything groundbreaking. We do it a lot. I'd like to think we do it reasonably well, but there's nothing particularly groundbreaking about this. But I think what Kingdom brought to the project is the thing that actually makes it most, the things that actually made it a success, because the engagement went all the way through the planning, well, way beyond the planning stage, all the way right through to the handover of the project, setting people in the new homes. We engaged with the tenants all the way through. There was a lot of tenants who had particular housing needs due to disabilities. So there was one-to-one engagement with them. There was an extremely complex decanting equation to solve, and Kingdom did a fantastic job managing that. So as few people as possible actually had to move out of their homes. They made the phasing of it extremely complex, but that was handled a great deal of care and consideration by Kingdom. Because I think they realized very clearly this was a placemaking project, wasn't just a development construction project. And that human dimension, I think, is the thing that so easily gets squeezed out by the challenging process we all have to navigate to deliver any project of this kind of scale. So, I mean, here's a range of the people who are involved: Kingdom Housing Association, Fife Council, residents, the contractor, representing the Scottish Government, and we even got a Cabinet Secretary of Community Local Government in this photograph. And I wanted to show it because I think it's one of the few instances where I've really seen proper coordination between all levels of people involved. So we've got a cabinet minister here on one hand, all the way down to the residents who live there. That was all joined up and coordinated. And I think that is the key to the success here. But going back to the master plan for a moment, I think one of the key things that came out of the engagement early on, which we'd identified in a kind of physical assessment of the place, was a real sense of disconnection, both physical disconnection, actually social disconnection. And one of the reasons behind that was a physical dimension. This is looking down Fraser Avenue, it kinks at the bottom, but it's actually an extremely, extremely long road. You can get in at either end. There's very few routes across it beyond very narrow, twisty alleys, which you wouldn't really choose to go down on a dark night. So the fundamental shift in master planning terms was really breaking Fraser Avenue up and getting away from the canyon and creating much smaller scale spaces, breaking the main street into two parts and putting a village green at the very, very center. So it was a process of trying to make the neighborhood far more connected with surrounding neighborhoods. And part of that was physical and about actual routes and connections, which would physically connect it to the surrounding neighborhoods. But part of it was also the social dimension. There was a real stigma about, say, Fraser Avenue. Since everyone was going, you wouldn't go there unless you needed to go there. So this is a new park space in the very center at that kind of fracture point, but the old Fraser Avenue is broken in two and no longer is the Fraser Avenue it was before. And this is connecting to kind of transverse routes, which connect it into the local neighborhood as well. So it's about trying to construct the master plan in a way that encourages and facilitates and cultivates social mixing to get away from really the state of ghettoization that Fraser Avenue was in before. The other dimension is the shops, and this is why I come back to the black and white photograph from earlier. We moved all the shops from the center of the site in the middle point of the canyon to actually one end, which was right on the main route to the local high school, which was just up the road. And the retailers came with it, which was fantastic. It was extraordinarily complicated and difficult to make that happen, but it did happen. And again, this is it's really something that's embedded in the master plan, which is a physical move to actually facilitate more social integration between what was this, the Fraser Avenue, almost isolated community and the wider community. So these shops are now used far more widely by the wider community. The shops got much better trade, got much better stock, they're trading much better. School kids stop off there on their way to school every day, and it's become a real positive social mixing point for Fraser Avenue residents and also the wider community. So really this is about how to kind of reconnect Fraser Avenue with the rest of town, both socially and physically. And this is it today. That was CGI, this is it today. You can see the shop on the right, and you just about read it, says Stevens the Bakers, which was the same name on the sign from the 1980s. So this is at the very north end of the site, the bottom of the plans and images I've shown. And this is part of a wide range of things that were embedded in the master plan. I like to think that a series of small moves and gestures and triggers and catalysts to cultivate the softer side of placemaking. The fundamental one was that people were moving away from, you know, a shared, unsecure lobby which served all the walk-up flats in these blocks, which people often said they have to step over, you know, passed out druggies and needles to get to their homes. It's a very simple premise, but everybody has their own front door. Even the flats are walk-up cottage style flats with their own stabling up. And that was a fundamental thing. And this was all about trying to fundamentally shift perceptions and completely change perceptions. And the goal here, when we started it, was that how can we turn Fraser Avenue from being the worst place to live in Brookhaven to one of the best places. And you know, that's the kind of thing I think a lot of us would find ourselves saying at a pitch. And I think the gratifying thing here is actually that has actually come to pass, but it's not all down to us. It's the fact that it was a complete joined up process.
Ewan, we need to wrap up now.
Okay, nearly there. I think the final thing I just want to say is that, thankfully, Architecture Design Scotland have documented the whole process once in a case study and also in a workshop where there was a feedback from local residents. And I have to say, I was a bit fearful of walking into this. What kind of feedback are we going to get? But actually, it was one of the most gratifying experiences I've had working as an architect. And there was three things that just stick in my mind. And it was things that, certain things that the residents said. One of them was, people are talking to the neighbours again. Someone else said, the children are playing in the streets again. And for me, the real one was, I feel so much better. I'm off my meds now. And this woman had been plagued with ill health for years in a damp home. And now she was actually feeling so much better to the point where she was off medication. So this has been, I think, a great achievement, but one that's not down to us. It's really down to the everybody who's involved. And actually, it's one of the few times I've seen a complete joined up process from start to finish, coordinated at every level, with driving enthusiasm all the way through. And perhaps unfairly, I'm going to quote something from the NDS report to finish off, which is that one of the conclusions once, there's a question as to how to replicate the Fraser Avenue process. It may not always be possible, as it requires substantial time, energy, resources, and will. I would say anything that's worth doing probably involves most of those, but that's a real challenge that faces all of us to deliver new homes and decent places for people to live. But we have to find a better way to make it more joined up at every level, so all the energy and effort really is focused on delivering this common goal. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, Ewan. I love your penultimate slide and the box over on the left, a place where people feel they belong, which is really important, because otherwise, why are we doing this? It's very difficult to achieve. And I think you've outlined that good process also leads to a good project outcome, and as well as a good experience for people. And these things necessarily go together. If the other speakers from the first session and this session like to unmute themselves, I've got a few things that have now been picked up off the chat feed, but I'm going to start off by putting John O'Mahony out of his misery on the choice of his opening image, which, if you recall, was of happy adults and children playing in the street of low-rise two-storey terrace housing in a very narrow lane with a little walk-up blocks at the end. This is Marmalade Lane in Cambridge. And the reason why it's such a good choice is that I was responsible for making that project happen, which is not the point of telling you the story, but to say something about why that is such a special scheme, and that the reason you chose it is that it is a place that's created by people. It was a site that was owned by the City Council in a large urban extension area, which had stalled after the social housing had been built in 2007 when the property market crashed, and the local authority owned the site. They felt that one of the ways they could try and kickstart activity again in the area to bring the developers back on would be to make the site available for a self-build group. And I was retained to advise them on what kind of self-building approach they should take. And they agreed to adopt a co-housing structure, so to recruit a co-housing group, and then to recruit a developer, a nice developer, who worked with them. And this was a very successful project, and it's been very widely illustrated. It's won loads of architectural awards, not necessarily a good thing. but it is, I think it is universally recognized as something that is rather remarkable. But the thing that's remarkable about it is that the rest of this area, Orchard Park, was built under a design code which has 387 pages in it. And Marmalade Lane breaks almost every rule in the design code. So we did have a few problems at planning, But the overriding thing that the group, when they were recruited, said was, this place has no streets where you would want to live. These are the streets for cars to drive down. So they were determined to try and recreate within their site a street which was populated as a kind of social space, which is what you saw. And that wasn't a CGI image, it was a photograph. Mm. And I think that's a really important aspect of what I'd like to explore in the rest of the session. I want to go back to the question that I quoted earlier from Henry about how you make housing a justiciable human right. I don't want to get into the legal aspects of it, if you don't mind, Henry, but I would like to the panelists to kind of think about how would something like that give the citizen more leverage on the kind of housing policies and the kind of housing solutions that are available. And Sue has spoken quite a lot about what she's doing in kind of community-led projects. In the chat, Janet Sutherland and Nick Falk have been talking about housing for older people, and that in mainland Europe, there's quite a lot of co-housing that's driven by groups of older people as an appropriate retirement choice through co-housing groups and indeed through cooperatives, where there is a much better enabling framework with access to land and access to capital in ways that are less readily available in the UK and in the Republic. So maybe I'll go back to Sue, but maybe the others could also think about in what ways could citizens be involved more creatively in the making of new places. Kevin Murray's put it, you know, a better community fit for new developments. So Sue, over to you to start with.
I think neighbourhood planning groups have been a, we've got them in England and Wales, I think. I'll defer to you real policy experts as to where it is. Have been a great place where people can start to think locally. It's not just a way to push back from any development. They realise that they do need homes for people like in Chobham. They said that even the GP and some of the nurses that work at local hospital can't afford to live there, and that they want people who can provide those services. So I think having a conversation locally, whatever the context is, about this and making a space for it. I think people don't feel empowered and they don't realise what they can do. Not everybody's going to, you know, go out there and build a housing development, but a lot of the consultation is very cynical by developers. It's very cynical. You can't actually discern what's really going to happen the way the drawings are done. And that's just, that sort of consultation is terrible and cynical. So I would say whatever the mechanism is, whether it's post-COVID regeneration, people getting involved and talking about housing, and I had a thought just on that justiciable issue, that I think there are some good lawyers out there. I can't remember them. There's actually an organisation that works on, for example, they're taking ecocide as a, to try and make that a law. I think it's just a long piece of work to try to draw attention to the fact that actually this isn't acceptable. So I think there's a need for people working at different levels, whether it's legal campaign groups or community groups, and getting involved with whatever is kind of going on at the moment, whether it's neighbourhood planning or post-COVID regeneration and involving people. How can we make our place better is the sort of key way I'd attract people on a poster.
Ewan, you wanted to come.
Yeah, I want to pick on this point. I think the out of the range of things, I think I'm always interested in what are the mechanisms that might finally shift direction. And I think for me, trying to turn planning and consultation planning completely around so that consultation is no longer a reactive thing to a proposal, but actually the engagement is much further up the line that actually engages in local planning. We've been involved in this through charrette process with Scottish Government and Loughran Forest National Park, albeit it's not a local authority, it's a relatively small planning authority, But all of the engagement we did on that and small settlements and around Loch Lomond Trossachs actually defined the local plan. So the local plan became a people-led, place-led document that actually set the agenda. So the consultation sets the agenda for what the plan should deliver. Now that's filtering through in Scotland in the new planning bill, but there's possibly a settling in period, because I think one downside of it, it's a risk of being effectively used by those who don't wish to see any new development or any new homes built, actually using it as a means to block and delay good development. But fundamentally, I think one of the key shifts is the planning becomes more focused on positive planning, I suppose, as Jane Jacobs would call it, rather than reactive development control. And it's a mind shift, but I think if there is a mind shift within planning, that could be one of the key things, because a lot of the things that have been talked about, such as how to capture land values and cultivate and manipulate land values, will actually come from that key gateway of the planning process.
Janice, just talking about that cultural mind shift, is in the work that local authorities do, often community groups or engaging with citizens is seen as a bit of an inconvenience, an unnecessary part of the process, and that local authorities feel that you know they have to focus on kind of what they do. But I just wonder to what extent there is scope in these kind of locally appropriate solutions that local authorities are doing to be more open with communities, not necessarily to do a community-led housing scheme, but to involve communities more proactively in the way that Ewan was describing.
Well, obviously, if you are going to do a scheme using the housing revenue account on existing old council housing, then obviously you've got to engage residents, and that's now a requirement. So, and as many councils see intensification on those estates as and diversification perhaps of housing types as well on those estates, then that's very important. So there are some good examples of where that's happened. Places like Hackney, where the council hasn't been able to go ahead, but the estate has gone ahead with a private developer and with the council's assent, but nevertheless produced something which is very interesting in terms of mixed tenure. And the private sector housing now on that development has created a huge fund, which, having had all the council flats completely redone, they've still got 70 million in the pot. So, you know, there are some good stories about that. In other councils, then, large and small, you do actually see this kind of, it depends at what point in the process, but you certainly see that councillors are both giving commitments and being held to account by their communities. Now, that's not necessarily at the same point of actually in terms of design, and the involvement of the detail. But nevertheless, there is, I think, you're seeing a much greater interrelationship between, and it's encouraging councillors on actually, where there is an expectation. And when you get the stories like Wolverhampton or North Caerstephen or South Lakeland or Plymouth, all of which are doing things in different ways, Bristol, where the community see that council's doing something, then that general support is important to councillors. Now, that doesn't mean to say that there's detailed design engagement in every council, but I think this is a good first step, that expectation and that mutual support, because councillors will see that that will have an effect in the ballot box and will continue their efforts. Mm-hmm. So perhaps a slightly higher level generally, but there are specific examples.
Can I make a point, Stephen?
Yes, can I repeat? Yes, Peter.
Sorry, I can't use the same systems as everybody else because I can't see computer screens. So okay. I've just left. Look, no, I'm serious. I've got a serious eyesight problem. I'm partially sighted. All I can see is on the very, very big screen. So I don't have any mechanism for contacting you. Just two points. I think, first of all, it's about really giving people proper power so they can engage directly. And I think there's a real problem here that professionals like ourselves assume that people have the same tools and equipment to actually engage. They don't. We've just been doing some experiments in Northern Ireland through a thing called Building Successful Communities. We've had great support from Turley's in doing this. And it's a joint initiative between a series of government departments and the housing executive. And it comes out of work that I did with Jenny Piper many years ago. And we picked six communities which are really seriously disadvantaged. And we actually gave them, through Turley's, a voice so they could express their views and opinions. They find it, I mean, people just find it really difficult. I learned this years ago when I worked with Des McConaughey on the Shelter Neighbourhood Action Project in Liverpool in the early 70s. And you just need to find ways of letting people intervene properly. Just a second point. Local planning departments, as Janice said quite correctly, are hugely overwhelmed and understaffed by the tasks they need to achieve. The consequence is that they don't seem to be able to provide support anymore for people in local people in communities who wish to do things which diverge in any way from an approved local development plan. I've had a nightmare experience with a council in West Yorkshire trying to produce a neighbourhood plan. And it's reminiscent of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy approach, where you're welcome to consult, but you have to go to a different planet and find a cellar in the middle of the night and there's no lights to be able to actually engage with the process. And it's a massive, massive obstacle course for people. So I think, you know, the Academy of Urbanism could do us all a huge favour if we actually acknowledge some of these things and looked at some examples, such as the examples we've been looking at today, where people have been encouraged, supported, and truly enabled to participate. Otherwise, it's a sham, it's a chimera, it's never going to happen. Sorry, it's a bit of a rant, but I'm very strongly about it.
I completely agree. John and Marnie, you were talking a bit about some of the opposition that you're experiencing. How do you respond to some of the people?
Well, one of the most discouraging elements of it is that there's a national encouragement of densification, and then you find politicians leading the charge against anything that might sort of go above 3-4 stories, which is really disappointing. A couple of things. Back in the day when we were doing a very large regeneration project in Ballymun, we took a shop unit in the middle of the shopping centre, and we got set up, showed what we were at, and asked for commentary and so on. And of course, got absolutely inundated with commentary, which was fantastic. It all fed into the process. And then we then had a demonstration of where we were going, and we set up another exhibition, and 9,500 of the 14,500 citizens turned up. And every single one of them said, this is wonderful, this is great, this is fantastic, this will never, ever happen. The amount of disillusionment and a lack of trust, you know, in their public services and their public servants was manifest. It actually did, to a certain degree, happen. But a couple of the things I was thinking about there was in trying to encourage and understanding, the RIA and the Irish Planning Institute put together three seminars for councillors in Dublin, Cork and Limerick. And what we did was we put together a series of presentations about what the nature of density really is, some very good examples of what it might be, including Marmalade Lane, I might add, and also trying to educate on what density really is, what it can and look like, and also how you deal with the quality issues as well as the quantity issues, and what's the real traffic impact, and what's the real visual impact that these have. And it was it started as though it was going to be wonderful, and then they called it a general election, and half the councillors disappeared off to do their canvassing. So we're going to run it again. But as part of that discussion, what we were also promoting, and I think it was mentioned there earlier on, was we have to take a much longer term view of what densification is like and what it's going to look like. And therefore, in our development plans, we need to look at our suburban areas in particular. We need to look at the opportunities that are available and to do three-dimensional studies with all of our suburban areas and take a much longer view. Do what the Scandinavians are amazing. I mean, they'll take 10 years to prepare a plan and it'll be a 20-year plan, but it will have engaged with everybody. It will have been teased through. And then when you go and see the end results of that engagement and that community engagement, you see places like Hammarby, you know, you see these Royal Seaport, these wonderfully balanced, well-considered, beautifully landscaped suburbs, higher density suburbs. And then, of course, the final thing is what John was talking about. It's the land. The countries that seem to succeed in having a really well-balanced, well-developed suburban social housing and affordable housing are those who control the land value. So municipal ownership of land as part of that is so, so important.
Okay, thank you very much, John. Just one last point I want to raise with John Coleman. Are you still with us? Is that I know that we've had conversations about the extent to which the Land Development Agency can support directly community-led housing projects and the issues about land and access to capital. But I'm just wondering, in the context of the things that are being said about the productive results of engaging communities more proactively, is what scope the Land Development Agency will have to do that in its work, both either directly or through its development partners?
I think the simple answer is Stephen, much more. And I guess, you know, listening to the other speakers and a lot of things resonate there. I think the key for us is building trust that the engagement is authentic, that it's not just lip service. And I think there's more scope for a state body to do that. So I'm a public servant. My driver is delivery and affordable delivery rather than internal rate of return. And so I have more scope to have that transparency and openness. And it always struck me that when I spoke to the guy that was handling comms and communications for the development of the old Lansdowne Road rugby stadium, he said, look, in one, which was incredibly contentious in a very high kind of value area, he said that one thing that got across the line was just openness. And I think if the LDA is a state body and NGOs are the same, that we have the scope to do that. Like, with certain limitations, I should be quite happy for someone to come in and have a look at my spreadsheets, for me to explain to them why we're doing a certain thing, for them, me to explain why we're achieving density, for me to show them why we need to achieve a certain rent. And that should be, we should have nothing to hide. And I think you mentioned, what's the scope for the LDA to do that? I think it's much more than, as a public servant of a public body, it's much more than the private sector might be motivated to do, because they have different motivations and their job is slightly different to ours. One interesting point I think that we've found useful so far is at the early stage of the process, and Ewan talked about this, the proactive engagement versus the reactive. So very early in the process, we have identified an area around the main train station in Limerick. It's mainly state land. We haven't a clue, well, within reason, what might happen there, but we've ideas. And so what we've done is we've engaged the Royal Institute of Architects in Ireland to commission an independent design review involving, to give to the community, to say to the community, look, this is a vision for the area. What do you think? We're not saying it's right, we're not saying it's wrong. What do you think? So it's from the very first thoughts and ideas that we are engaging and taking on board the ideas and the concerns of the community. And rather than presenting them with a fait accompli, which is a master plan or even a more evolved design to say, here it is, now let's get this consultation over with as quickly as possible. So that really, really early stage consultation piece is a space, I think, particularly on the larger scale areas, that we have an opportunity to invoke people like the RIAI and our architect colleagues to help build the vision and to help get community engagement in that from the off. And as a state body and NGOs, I think there's significantly more scope to do that than other sectors.
Okay, thank you very much, John. Thank you very much, all the panelists. We need to wrap up now, let people go and have their lunch, get ready for the afternoon session. I'm really delighted with all the things that have come out today. We haven't been able to cover all the things that were coming through on the chat, but we've covered quite a few of the kind of the big issues. We could have a whole day on land, I've no doubt, but I think the idea of citizen being a more active partner in development seems to be a really important one with lots of different ways of approaching it. And that was one of the things that really struck me when we were in Eindhoven in June last year, was that this was a city where the politicians, the leading officials, the senior people in housing delivery partners, housing associations, developers, and the citizenry all had a very clear idea about what kind of city they wanted, in which affordable housing was just a really central and crucial part of how to make that city work well. And they have a very strong self-awareness of their kind of identity. I was just looking to see how Eindhoven had been faring in lockdown and in the reaction to COVID, and they have had quite high infection rates in that part of the Netherlands. But one of the things I thought was very striking was that the This Is Eindhoven website, run by the council, is full of, in English, really, really clear instructions about how to work with lockdown, things you should do, things you shouldn't do, and also an exhortation that the best thing you can do is to be outside. And one of the things that you could do, one of the first things they recommended was go on the architecture tour, suitably socially distanced. And they had that posted up on March the 24th as something that felt like a very kind of contented city, anxious for its citizens to know what's going on in its place. So thank you very much. Some of you will be back at 2 o'clock. And thank you for all the participants this morning.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.